You didn't see some of them?
No, you didn't. Anyway. And otherwise, I haven't heard from Rob, but we have a quorum, so we're moving ahead. Public comments, clearly there need not be a public comment period. Approval of previous minutes. Terry let me know that due to the snowstorm, they were not able to get the minutes done. So that can be postponed to the next time we meet. Chair report. Speaking of the next time we meet, I realize that I am indisposed on January 4th. I just sent you an email about
yes.
that.
Yep.
And I'd like to be there for two reasons. One is that we will be, and this is part of the second part of my chair report, we will be welcoming Molly Hale to the Tree Commission. She was appointed by the mayor.
Oh, wow.
So she will be joining us as of the new year. And I would love to be there to welcome her. I mean, it's not required, but it would certainly be nice. She's a buddy of mine, and I think she'll be a great asset to the commission. So I'm excited. The other reason I'd like to be there is that I had scheduled Carolyn Mish from the planning department to come and speak with us at that time. And because I feel like I had to make such a heavy pitch to get her to come, I think it would be a nice gesture if I were there too. Plus, I have some questions I'd just really like to ask, and I'd like to understand better how she thinks. She indicated that she feels things are going pretty smoothly now, and I would just like to understand whether that's whether that smoothness is now sort of enshrined in policy, or is it just smoothness relationally between she and Rich? So I really want to make sure that everything we do, we are institutionalizing it so that we can render ourselves obsolete if any of us need to be replaced. So
she's planning department?
She's planning, yes. She's permitting, specifically.
Yeah.
And so she works with Rich when it comes to permitting stuff. I would like to ask of the commission if they would be willing to do one of three things. One is postpone having Carolyn come to the meeting, or cancel the January 4th meeting and just pick up our new year agenda the next time we meet, which is 2 weeks later. I'd like you to weigh in because it has to do with how heavy we feel our load is, and it has been light up to this in the last couple of meetings. So if it's going to continue to be light anyway, then maybe it wouldn't be such a bad thing if we got another week off. We are, after all, meeting twice as often as the typical commission. So anyways, we can sit on that, and maybe I'll have you weigh in during your little report.
Sure.
That's it for me, really.
Do we want to...
Oh, and Molly Freilicher should be here. She said she was coming. So that would be nice to hear from her, too.
If we don't meet on the 4th, might we want to meet on the 11th and the 18th?
I don't think that's necessary, and it's... I feel like people have scheduled into their lives the 1st and 3rd, so I think I would like to just keep it simple and say, do we want to cancel the meeting on the 4th? If we don't, that's fine. I'm sure Todd can run the meeting perfectly fine. And then the question is, should I reschedule Carolyn so that she can at least be there when I'm there? So.
Is there information that might be available from the inventory?
I am hoping I got a bill the other day.
Don't pay it until they give you the goods.
Well, we have to pay them for the actual work, field work. The invoice for the report has not come yet, but the report, they said possibly I would get it by tomorrow.
Well, that's great.
But I haven't heard from them, so I.
And is it? But you had, I think, said to me earlier that we're segueing into your chair report. Your tree warden report. You had said to me that you wanted to have the mayor and yourself cast your eyes on it before you circulated to us. Is that correct?
No, I think it was the other way around in the email. I think I said that I would like to have, I'm going to read it first.
Yeah.
And then I think the commissioners should read it.
Okay.
And then we should actually decide how we want to, it is a public document, but I think, you know, if the mayor wants to read it, he can read it. I'm not going to say you can't read it. But in order for us to present a strategic plan based upon the report, if myself and the commission should go in, you know, or should speak to the mayor about strategically how we want to try to implement this plan. So I'm just, I want to proofread it first to make sure that it's what I feel is an accurate representation, you know, based upon the information that I know already that they have, you know, that they have collected. You know, and I don't want any surprises to jump out at the mayor either.
Okay, all right. I think I,
you know, like, for example, there's 5,000 trees that need to be cut down like tomorrow, you know, which is not the case, obviously, but, you know, something extreme of that.
Right, right.
The alarm bells would go up. So I'm gonna read it, and once I have it, then I will probably communicate with the mayor and ask him how he wants me to disseminate the information. Does he want to read it first before it becomes a public document? Does, you know, can I give it to the commission at the same time? What would you like me to do with it? Because I take my direction, you know, from him in this aspect.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I'm assuming I was gonna have it in this week, but if not, next week, because they're pretty close. Because they actually emailed me the acknowledgement page in the back to make sure that it was correct. And this group was acknowledged, Tree Northampton was acknowledged, the mayor's office, Andy Keither.
Hey, Molly.
DCR. Yeah, and actually be with the first draft of the inventory.
Okay.
So. Like, I guess, I mean, so as far as the two, I mean, personally, I think we could probably just get away with one meeting next month. It's the middle of winter. It's kind of, you know, I mean, the only pressing thing on my end is that Rob and myself, we were talking the last time we met about actually putting together a planting request list or from Amherst Nursery for trees, because we will have monies at the end of this fiscal year that we're in to purchase trees under a contract, and Amherst Nursery has an extension for the combines contract, so we can buy directly from them, providing we get three quotes like we did before. But we also have that new list that we've all been working on for you know, trees that we'd like to see planted in Northampton. So we've kind of got to merge that document with what Amherst has available, you know, and give John enough time if we want specific species that he doesn't have to get until he can find them.
Okay, a couple of questions about that.
Yeah.
One is, how many more setback requests are you still working through?
I believe that all of the setback requests have been fulfilled, with the exception of a few late ones that came after all the inventory was used up.
Okay, so that's not something we could fall back on, is continued setback plantings until we really, because the tree inventory obviously doesn't address setback plantings.
It does not.
There may be more setback plantings coming, though, because periodically Tree Northampton does various tables or whatever, you know, is disseminating information about the setback program. So I'm not privy to, like, their comprehensive, what they're doing.
Yeah, and I'm going to be, I'm going to definitely be distributing those leaflets to my neighborhood as well. You know, I feel like we're exactly where we were last year, which is the cart is kind of trying to get in front of the horse once again, because I really would like the tree inventory to guide us in terms of...
The tree inventory is going to guide us, but one of the things that, after using Tree Keeper, that, you know, it's just a dot on a map, and you still have to physically actually go and look. Mm-hmm. You know, it tells you what's there, no overhead wires, but you still actually physically have to put your eyes on it.
But it does, I can appreciate that, but it also tells you whether or not you need a small, medium, or large tree.
That's correct.
So that's really important information. So
it,
I'm just wondering
is.
if when you and Rob get together, whether you will be availing yourselves of the tree inventory.
Yeah, I think it's three things. It's the inventory, and how that's going to, the inventory based upon the actual tree locations and what we have. So I want to run a report to see exactly how many of the 2,000 spaces are large, medium and small trees. Second of all, we have our recommended species list. And then thirdly, we have to figure out what stock is available to us.
And then I would say fourthly, going back to, well, maybe fourthly and fifthly, going back to Todd's comments about considering how we want to plan, do we want to consider having all of one type of species or emphasizing all of one type of species along certain roads? You know, getting diversity citywide, but then having some continuity of aesthetics and style along certain roads. That's one. And then the last one is, what streets are we prioritizing?
Well, those are all good questions that really need to be looked at. But the only thing is I know is at the end of the fiscal year, if I haven't secured a contract, the money goes back to the general fund. So the sooner that we actually figure out what species of trees we want to plant based upon the locations that are available to us in the public right of way, based upon what you were just talking about, the better off we'll be, because I think if DCR still has a contract with Amherst Nursery for more plant material. So the state, in a sense, John's been very good to us, but the state gets priority because of the...
Yeah, we're planting a lot.
Yeah, because they're planting all the state, which is awesome, right? Yeah. So, but I think...
And is Amherst Nursery the only nursery we're considering?
It's the only grow bag nursery that I'm aware of. Uh-huh. Unless there's... I don't think... People will say, yes, oh yeah, we have bags, yeah, and you go down into plastic containers. Mm-hmm. It's not bags.
Well, the other thing is that you can... we can buy them, but we don't have to receive them, right? We can, if there's some,
like we did this year, we had a contract and we told John that we're not going to come and take them to the fall.
Yeah.
But it was stock that he already had. Uh-huh. So it was already there, so he was okay with that.
What about buying stock in the spring for deliveries in the fall?
We can do that as well, because we still, don't forget, have about half of the stock still at Amherst Nursery. So we only planted half of the trees. We
got
164. So we only planted half as a setback plantings and some in the public right of way for replacements of the bare root trees that died.
Right.
So we still have half of the stock to go for this until this spring. And then once we're done, we won't plant over the summer. And then we have a whole other batch for the fall,
okay,
if we so desire to do that.
And these monies that need to be expended by the end of the fiscal year, do you have, let's say the tree inventory reveals that there are some, I don't want to say high risk, trees that require urgent addressing. Mm-hmm. Do you have sufficient funds for that? Like, what if some of those could be cabled, or probably not. Probably those won't be your highest priority funds, but I'm just wondering if, you know, some of the funds need to go towards that, addressing that. Let's say it's really shockingly large number, and it's something you really need to spend a lot of time and resources addressing.
Then we need to either, that's a good question too. I mean, there's a couple different ways you could do it. You could decide that this year we're just not gonna plant any trees, and we're gonna do all that extra work. But the problem is that line item that's in there is not used for personal services. So if you contract with a vendor and the vendor comes back and it says materials used and then it says labor hours, it's coded to a different part of the budget which doesn't have that kind of money in it. Mm-hmm. So the line item that we have is $40,000 is for trees, shrubs, and anything related to the tree crew. So if we were to need to do a large scale where we actually had to hire an outside company, like say Lewis Tree Service, for example, to do work for us, we would have to have a different contract. It would come from a different pot of money.
And that would come from a different pot of money.
That's correct.
The mayor couldn't authorize that money to be used for...
He cannot authorize that. The money, he would be inclined to probably actually, because of the nature of the amount of work, would probably see it go in front of city council,
yeah,
and request a financial,
yeah,
transfer.
Which is reasonable. It's a reasonable...
Well, it is reasonable, but you're not going to know really until we're able to actually run a report to see exactly what we're up against. But from talking with the guys who were out in the field at Davy Tree, there's not, you know, I think they called me three times for high risk trees that were in danger of, you know, know, like imminent danger.
Oh, okay.
Falling. I mean, there are definitely removals that need to happen, and there's going to be more removals because of all the ash trees that are identified, especially up towards Sylvester Road.
Were they identified with the?
No, no one's identified seeing emerald ash borer at the moment, but it's, there's other borers that have decimated these trees. So I think it's really going to be, it's going to be like, I feel like we're juggling a bunch of balls here, like we were last year, the same kind of thing. We've got a, but we have a different tool now in our toolbox, which is going to really kind of tell us what direction that we need to go in.
So it is possible then that if we get this report very soon, that we can start, not just the report, but also Tree Keeper, that we can start using it to inform the purchase, the upcoming purchase.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't see why not. But again, we have, you know, our own list that we want to work with, and then we have what's available. And the sooner that we tell Amherst Nurseries what we would like to have, the sooner he can go find it. Maybe we can meet Molly's folks there. I mean, sorry, Molly. Maybe we can get a little ahead of DCR, but probably not. But there's just a lot of demand because they're awesome trees and they do really well.
And nurseries are still recovering from 2008.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, is that where a lot of your money's coming? Or a lot of your trees are going to? Is, you mean, you, by 2008, you mean?
The crash.
Oh, the crash.
So
oh, okay.
So kind of ramped down.
All right, okay.
So now they're.
And where are your trees going to?
Where are they going?
Yeah.
So we have this Greening the Gateway Cities planting program, which will be in 13 cities. Not all coming from Amherst Nursery, but a good number are. So we are definitely putting some pressure on. At least the state nurseries, they will Amherst.
Well, so let me just wrap up the how we got into this conversation. We got into this conversation by the question of, do we want to have a January 4th meeting? Do you feel like there are some people who could peel off and help guide you in the decision-making around the Amherst Nursery tree order?
Yep.
And that a full meeting of the commission is not necessary?
Probably not. I think it would be good to kind of branch off and have a few commissioners, Rob, maybe Jen and Jay, if they're willing.
Sure.
To kind of go over,
I've loved,
to go over there, to go over the planting recommendations. And then maybe we could use that the Vermont guide that actually talks about the different designs in planting, you know, clump planting along streets with multiple species, but in clumps at intersections, and try to come up with some kind of a plan where Davey's identified there can be multiple trees planted.
Yeah.
But we won't know that until we're able to really digest the data. So, yeah. But I mean, I think it would be kind of, in my opinion, it would be kind of a waste of the full commission's time.
Okay.
Talking about that, I think it would be, say, you know, come back, here's the plan, this is what we'd like to do based upon what we have.
Okay.
Well, if we get the inventory thing to read, you know,
yeah,
in between, before the, yeah, whatever the next meeting, that would, you know, it kind of gives people more time to like really look at it. And
right. Will the commission have, at least if we meet, not the 4th, but the 15th? No, 19th? 18th? Thank you. Will we have, does commission have an opportunity to just weigh in on what you're doing before it happens, or will it, that be already done by then?
I doubt it'll be already done by then.
Okay, all right.
I mean, I think the goal would be to, would be nice to get Amherst Nursery a list in February.
Okay, all right.
So basically, the kind of the spring wake-up calls, the Mass Tree Wardens and Foresters Conference, right, and then there's the community tree form of UMass. That's the real wake-up call in spring here. And then if you don't have your planting stock ordered by then, you're in trouble. And all the years, the 2 years we've done this, we've waited until the, you know, until the 8th, to the 9th hour to put it in an order. And luckily, John's had stuff over there that we've had, but we've had to buy, you know, clumps of certain trees, and we can't get exactly everything that we want. And those were good for setbacks, but we're looking to plant trees in the public right of way. And a lot of underwire trees.
Yeah. Be curious to see how many of the spots they identified were underwire ones. Probably a ton.
So So, I mean, I think, again, it's just really, just analyzing the data.
Well, I'm very interested in really, really looking closely at the data and kind of coming up with some of those statistics that will help guide us. I mean, that's interesting to me. I don't know if there's any other people that like to bore through data like that, but... All right, listen, we're in the middle of the tree warden report. Do you have any other tree warden reporting to do?
No.
No? That's it?
I'm just working on Trees City USA. The deadline is the 31st.
Current deadline.
Yep.
Done. Clear one. It's December 31st?
December 31st.
Sorry if I missed the timing, but when do you think they'll have their report, the inventory folks?
They told me they would have it to me by tomorrow, the actual urban forestry management plan.
By tomorrow, okay.
Yeah. Tree Keeper is live, and I'm an administrator now, so we can actually use it for... it's not read-only anymore, so we can actually use the work order system. But I just need to schedule the time when Terry and I both have like an hour to sit down and talk over the phone with the IT guy from Davey to kind of walk us through what the system can do. So basically, I can go in there and I can mess everything up if I'm not careful, which I kind of want to avoid.
Yeah.
But so I'm excited to try that, but it's just been, we've had two snowstorms and things just were kind of off the rails at the moment, so.
Is it possible or preferable to share that with me so I can incorporate stuff into our annual report, or do you want me to wait until our next meeting, which won't be for another month?
What would you be looking to incorporate?
You mean the...
Well, that annual report that I drafted this fall, we were going to finalize it once we had the tree inventory info, and if they give it to you tomorrow, between now and our next meeting on the 18th of January, I could be reworking the annual report with that info.
Okay. Well, let's wait and see what we get, and once I proofread it, we'll go from there.
Okay.
I think it would be kind of interesting, and this is kind of long-term, but it would be kind of nice, actually, with the tree inventory, if the mayor would be willing, depending on what our approach is, once we have the document and what our recommendations are to him, is that we actually do some kind of a PowerPoint presentation in front of the whole city council.
Oh, that's my intention. Yeah, absolutely.
And in using, because we'll have the tree inventory will be, not tree inventory, but the urban forestry management plan will be electronic, so we can use it as a PowerPoint presentation.
Okay.
Or parts of it anyway, at least, not the whole thing, obviously. Mm-hmm. But so that would be something I think that would be interesting. Sort of like what Donna, the director, is actually doing a PowerPoint presentation about the stormwater utility in January in front of the city council. Mm-hmm. You know, we're required to give yearly updates as to what the stormwater utility has done.
Mm-hmm.
So,
you know, if you and Terry are getting trained in Tree Keeper over the phone, would it be okay if I took part in that? Because especially if I'm going to give a presentation and if I'm going to be really boring into the data, I would love to just have the opportunity to understand the system much better.
Sure, I have no problem with that. Just have to pick a time limit.
Okay.
When we're all available.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, so just to tie this completely in a knot, is it okay if we cancel the January 4th meeting?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, done. I will contact Carolyn Mish and let her know that we'll need to reschedule. Thank you. Appreciate that, everybody. And I'll also let Molly Hale know. We have a new Molly on our
team.
Yeah, she's great. And in fact, you met her during the
inventory.
The inventory, yeah.
Great.
She's terrific.
But she spells her name with a Y, not an I.
Yeah. Okie dokie. So we sort of blended a tree warden report and tree inventory update, and now we are 3 minutes ahead of time. How about that? Okay, so Molly, thanks for coming. You're actually on the agenda. can you zoom way out and just give us a big picture report on how things are going statewide? I don't know. I mean, that's always really helpful to kind of know how this little commission fits into the broader goals of the state. And then we can just have a conversation.
Sure. So statewide, I already mentioned the Greening the Gateway Cities program, and that is a state-funded tree planting program, planting trees for energy savings. It keeps getting bigger and bigger, which is great.
And in Western Mass, Molly, what cities are represented?
Holyoke, Chicopee, Pittsfield.
Springfield?
Springfield.
Okay.
That may be it.
Not Greenfield?
Greenfield's too small in population.
Yeah, I see, as is Northampton, right?
Yes.
What is the threshold?
Put me on the spot.
It's okay.
I'm not sure. It's sort of like mid-population size.
For energy savings, that's the focus.
For energy savings, so this is funded by non-compliance funds. And the idea is that, you know, you can reach folks with light bulbs, and MassSave can reach folks who, you know, have $1,000 to spend to get, you know, a rebate, whatever, but you're not gonna reach sort of a lot of multifamily or absentee owner, sort of the older housing stock. So this sort of addresses that from the outside. It's a program that doesn't cost property owners anything except time to water the trees. So that's really gotten trees and kind of benefits of trees sort of really out there. And it's pretty exciting to see a state-funded program.
Setback plantings?
About 80% are on private property.
Yeah. And Molly, I mean, I know you don't have a crystal ball, but it seems like the gateway cities is low-hanging fruit, right? Because it's dense populations
right.
and so forth. Do you think that once they've picked all the low-hanging fruit, that there'll ever be monies for more?
So EEA has applied for a Forest Service grant. They applied last year and didn't get it. And are retooled it to sort of go to the next tier down. You know, sort of gateway cities that are smaller in population, like North Adams, Palmer, Ware, places like that.
Northampton.
Greenfield's
probably population is slightly smaller than ours, right? But it is more of, well, I don't know.
So there is a movement to try to address those communities, but sort of at this state level funding, it's still just these 26 communities
Looking
at that legislation.
Would it be reasonable to ask that if anything comes up that looks like Northampton could take advantage of, like if you know the threshold lowers again, mm-hmm. that you could notify us?
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah. Bob O'Connor at EEA is another guy who's been doing those grant applications.
I see. And they're all grant application based.
Yeah. So this is sort of like next year.
Okay. And is the money just for the trees, or is it the whole like structural soil, like pulling up of pavement?
So this is just for trees and kind of maybe light amending of the soil, but nothing major like that.
Seems like such a poor use of resources. Urban environments are so hostile to trees.
Yeah.
Gotta get engineers to understand and accept that. Mm-hmm. That's the problem. Mm-hmm. People making the designs mm-hmm. don't get it.
Mm-hmm. And certainly.
And it costs more, so.
Of course, but so do the tree fatality costs a lot, too.
But that's not gonna make people be like, oh, yes, it was sick. You know, because it doesn't die. That year.
Yeah, so that's partly why this is a lot of private property. Also to bring the trees closer
yeah.
to buildings.
Buildings.
So the idea is to have big canopy trees that are then gonna shade and prevent wind.
Okay.
What's the name of the program we have?
It's called Greening the Gateway Cities. So it's in urban and community forestry, but it has its own staff. So I just kinda go and take pictures and hang out sometimes. Oversee it at all. Otherwise,
I
know the threshold.
And do volunteers do the planting? Like, who's
oh, no, they hire seasonal laborers for the 3 month planting season. So it's all done in house, everything is hand dug, with the exception of some trees that, so the city is given some money to plant street trees.
And are they mostly planting grow bag trees? What are they planting?
It depends where the trees are coming from. A lot of the ones from John, of course, are in grow bags. So oleoak and chickpea, Huntsfield, and Leominster. And they're all doing grow bags. So
are grow bags being seen as preferable to, say, bare root plantings, or?
I don't think so. They're maybe they're easier to deal with in some ways. Not going to dry out.
Right.
But I don't know of other nurseries doing grow bags. So we only have three nurseries in the state contract, so it doesn't give us for statewide.
Have other states done a similar type of program?
I don't know of any that have done this.
Really?
You know, with sort of the energy angle, and then they're targeting parts of the cities, so very dense housing, environmental justice. I mean, a lot of these communities are, you know, mostly environmental justice in some cases. So working that angle, and then also doing research, putting up temperature sensors, so that we can get baseline data now and see as the trees grow, how does that change the microclimate? So working with UMass and other universities to do that, and quite a few cities. So.
Great. Questions, you guys, for Molly?
So I've missed this. Is a certain amount of money or a certain amount of trees? What sort of things are you quantifying?
They're quantifying, they're trying to get a certain number of trees per acre to get that density, because it's not just sort of a tree on one side of your house, because of course your good side to your neighbor's bad side. So it's really just trying to raise the canopy in defined blocks. So it can be tough because you may be on, you know, the boundary and your neighbor across the street is out of the planting zone. So, but they want to be able to have the data to back the program up in hopes that maybe other states or communities will do it.
It's ongoing or just this year?
There's funding through the governor's term. So the support of the administration, what happens after that, I don't know.
Before we walk out the door, I'd like to get just information from you on how people can get hired.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. But we don't spend
time
here.
Yeah, that's right, because you've got a whole...
Oh, yeah, and it's in spring.
She teaches horticulture at STEM.
Okay.
Yeah, so I teach in the landscape design and management.
Yeah, so Springfield hasn't gone first because they had gotten a good amount of funding because of the tornado.
Right.
But they'll be up and coming, and they do work with, I didn't mention, they work with a nonprofit partner in each community, and they in turn help, you know, recruit people. But yeah.
Yeah, I just want to, and even I have students in Chicopee and Oleo, so I just want to, they'd be.
Yeah, and the program, they're really trying, you know, they're planting a lot. It's hard, but they're also teaching, you know, sort of opening up a possible career for folks in the green industry, where there are always jobs.
Right. Cool.
Any other questions from Molly?
So it's a statewide program?
Yeah. So, yeah, and it's great to see, you know, that kind of investment. It's like $8 million a year.
Oh,
wild.
That's not tied into any federal money, is it?
It's entirely state and these alternative compliance payments. So that's a pretty big fund to be able to tap into.
I feel a little better. I'm a little worried that all of our resources in federal government are going to go away.
I don't say that.
I know.
Really?
I'm just,
you like,
you know,
your job?
I mean, it's like a total one. It's just, you know, I'm just in the back of my mind all the time.
Yeah, this is set through the governor. So.
Okay. Awesome. Good.
So that's the big picture.
Do you know who did the planting on the turnpike going, or is it 91?
91.
91.
And going toward the 3-year field?
Yeah, what the heck?
Who did that?
Who, what, contractor? Where that new bridge was put in?
Like, how did that happen?
I don't know, I haven't seen it.
New bridge was put in.
Mass dot.
Oh, yeah, it's gonna be DOT.
It's Mass dot, they approved them.
It's horrendous. It's a huge waste of money and just horrendous.
Where is it?
If you drive north on 91.
Probably be between exits 25 and 26, or maybe 24 and 25.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
On the right, it's on the right and side.
Northbound on the right, yeah. Between, I think it's between Deerfield and Greenfield.
Yeah, but they replaced the bridge.
So it's between exits 25 and 26. Yeah.
Yeah, there's an off for this.
It's awful.
Oh, it's the selection, they planted, you know, trees and shrubs on 3-foot centers. They planted them this summer, you know, I mean, it's unbelievable.
Yeah, it's negligent.
I can't even.
It really is, it really.
You should write a letter to somebody.
Yeah, well, I just wouldn't, that's why I asked, who did it?
Yeah.
It was terrible.
Mass dot, it looks to me like it was just, it was basic mitigation, because the plant material doesn't make any sense to me.
No, totally.
Because there's a lot of plant material behind it that is just, you know, just all entangled and stuff. But they planted everything so far away, it's gonna have really no impact on the highway. Of course, they don't want the highway to be shaded, but still, it just, I watched them a lot, because I go to Greenfield a lot, and I was like.
Yeah.
Right.
And the plant material sat out there all summer.
Oh, totally. Half, 3/4 of it's gonna be dead.
Yeah.
It's, oh, what, oh.
You know, it does take, though, educated citizens to call that out. There needs to be a paper record.
Yeah, I just didn't know, even know who to, but it's Mass dot.
Yeah, and if you email me.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
Molly, any advice about our next steps? Like, we're about to get this tree inventory in our hand. Would it be helpful for us to send it to you not immediately, but, you know, I'll take other people's input. But just to say, this looks good, thumbs up, or, oh, this piece is missing. Make sure you get this from them before you close your.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure it's gonna be comprehensive.
Yeah, they've done it so many times.
Yeah. But yeah, I'd definitely like to see it.
Yeah, especially if there's something that, you know, jumps out at you, like, oh, this is a great opportunity.
Yeah, and it sounds like you're already taking, like, the exact steps you should, you know, really grasping the data. Applying it, and there may be other tools you can use to help you evaluate kind of how you go about prioritizing where you plant.
Yeah, well, to that point, are you pretty familiar with Tree Keeper?
Generally. It's been a while since I used it, but I think it looks pretty similar.
I mean, is it like a database where you can run reports? Mm-hmm. You know, you can add query, and then, so, yeah, all right. If you have any ideas once you get it in your hand of further questions we should be asking of the data.
Sure.
That would be helpful.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, this is exactly what we should be doing, inventory, using it.
Okie dokie.
I guess before we wrapped up that question about the tree inventory, are there any particular things that other cities or towns have learned from tree inventories that we should be on the lookout for?
I think
to make sure it's included in the report, or
I think you're kind of past a lot of the issues I've seen towns encounter, like there being way more trees than they thought. Costing a lot more. I think you're good, and thinking about those things already, that's great, and how you can apply, and, you know, just like.
What is the next thing we should ask of DCR in the way of a grant? Is it too early to tell? Would you need like the tree inventory in your hand, Eagle, to?
No, I mean, what do you want to do?
You want to be very strategic about, well, I think, I mean, I don't want to speak for everybody, but I can think of two things. One is we want to leverage all the money we can so that we, all the resources we can, so we make the most of our program. But I think that they are going to present us with an urban forestry management plan. Mm-hmm. Then I guess we've got to make it our own.
Yep.
I don't know if we can just go, this is now ours. This like represents everything we want to do. I have a feeling that it's going to need to be more comprehensive than that. It's not going to address things like ordinance issues or permitting process or stuff like that. So that's another thing, is just create our own urban forestry management plan. Mm-hmm. But then also just be really strategic in everything we implement going forward in terms of leveraging money and resources and doing it right the first time.
Mm-hmm. So if you get this report, and it's not just a report, right? It's a plan. You know, and it wasn't exactly what you wanted, and you thought you needed to develop it more and needed help. I mean, you could apply for a grant for a consultant to do that, although you have good people here to do that. You could talk about low-hanging fruit, use it to apply for a strategic planting grant, $20,000 matched with your amount. You know, if you wanted to do a big planting blitz, it would look very good to sort of be, whatever you're doing, you know, say that, you know, because of our inventory, this is, you know, the next step we're taking.
And that, you said, is a maximum $20,000?
The maximum is 30, but 20 is the highest limit you can do, kind of without like discussing it with us.
Okay.
So we just introduced sort of tiering to try to, because everybody wants to plant trees and that's all well and good, but you need to have a plan, you need to have, you know, it's more than just planting. I don't know what else. If there was a need, you know, the Rob's group, you know, if they could apply for a grant to help them develop into, you know, a bigger, more effective advocacy organization, I mean, they can do that.
Okay, once they get 501c3 status.
Right.
Yep.
You know, really, like, what you want to do, I mean, we have these categories that we like to see, but it's also sort of other projects as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And am I correct in that if we were to focus planting on areas of environmental justice, that it's a 75%, 25% matching?
Yep.
Okay.
So, but then the entire grant project has to focus only.
Okay.
You can't divide it up.
And is that also up to 30K?
Mm-hmm. 75 DCR, 25 city.
Mm-hmm.
And how does there's criteria that area meets? Like
areas
it's clear.
Designated by DEA.
Yeah.
So okay, so that's already established,
mm-hmm.
this area, that area, uh-huh.
Yeah,
okay.
Every 10 years
they
do that. So that's on Mass GIS.
And who's EEA?
Sorry, that's our Secretary of Energy and Environmental Affairs.
Okay.
So DCR falls under
Energy and Environmental Affairs.
Executive Branch.
Okay. Yep, okay.
So we could probably ask the planning office to give us the locations of all of the environmental justice sites in Northampton.
Yeah, and there are lots of ways to calculate environmental justice. The councils of government do it differently. So we've gotten grants where it's not the same environmental justice areas. So there is on Oliver, I think. There's a data viewer online you could look as well. You wouldn't need to necessarily go.
Where did you say, what was the site?
It's Mass GIS.
Okay.
It's also on the grant application. I can email
okay.
you.
All right.
Okay. It's called the Environmental Justice Viewer.
Okay.
What about updating inventory? Now that we have it done, we need a system to keep it current. Have other cities come up with plans for how to do that? that you're aware of?
Like Springfield and Amherst are trying to update in real time. Eventually, there may come a point where you sort of just have to do it all again. But ideally, you could get, I don't know, at least 10 years out of inventory if you're able to keep everything updated and ensure the new trees you're planting.
We're hoping that'll happen with the new system, Rich?
Well, I'm hoping that we will actually, because we have a lot of, so all the trees we planted this fall are not, so ones that are in the public right of way are not in the tree inventory. So I would like to actually.
Hey, David.
Happy holidays.
Thank you.
Merry Merry.
Thank you for appointing Molly to the or is that official yet?
Her application was put forward, so it's
to
not
the
official,
city council.
Official.
Yeah. Okay, when's the earliest she could?
They referred it to their committee. Their committee meets in early January, and then they'll send it back. So possibly by the end of January.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. She can start coming to meetings, but not vote.
She certainly could.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks again.
Thanks.
Thank you. See y'all later.
Bye. Bye. Bye.
Yeah, I think for a while Springfield had an intern who, over the summer, would do all the data entry.
So that you could write a grant for intern? I mean,
you could. Maybe throw something else in there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But yeah, definitely.
Oh. Sorry, I missed that one. What was that?
There could be like write a grant for an intern, like, you know, to input the plantings that we've done or, uh-huh, you know. It may not be enough.
So. Okie dokie. All right, we're wrapping it up here. Where are we? We are. Thank you, Molly, for all of that. All right, no one's here to give the Tree Northampton update, correct?
They haven't been doing much since last month.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you going to their meetings?
They haven't been meeting. They did a lot of tree planting this fall.
Yes.
And Rob said they're going to start meeting again probably in early New Year.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you for that. There's the Tree Northampton update. All right. I don't have on here other business not anticipated by the chair, but is there, since we have 5 extra minutes before we go into the to-do list recap?
Well, since this is our last meeting of the year, we can just go around and each say a highlight in the past year, because we have accomplished quite a bit. I'll start.
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, since I was involved with the Arbor Day, I was just really delighted to see trees planted at all of the elementary schools. I know some of them didn't make it at Leeds, but still, it was really thrilling to see children planting and excited and, you know, to drive by those schools and see those trees.
Hold on a
second. Well, we can do popcorn if people have
no pressure.
Well, I think just seeing the progress we're making to figuring out how to get in early on projects, and you know that we're not that. I think there's a lot of potential there, and I think we're on the right track. And you know, once we have this recommended tree list, and I just think that's where real change is going to happen, like where we can try to get them to start doing structural soil. And I think once it happens, you know, it'll be a domino effect.
Yeah.
So that's, yeah.
Glad to see we're progressing on the learning curve, learning what to do and what not to do, how to use people efficiently, how to work with nurseries, although that's a big, mm-hmm, big challenge always. But, I think we've made some progress, and we kind of know where we're going and how to go about it.
Molly, you can jump into it.
Terry?
Based
on what
you
know?
Yeah. No! No, Terry actually.
I actually,
go ahead, you talk.
I have a more of an appreciation for trees.
Yay, that's awesome.
Than I used to. So I appreciate that.
They're a wonderful species. Rich?
Wow, my list is long already. I don't know, we started out with a bang, we ended with a bang. So we planted all the bare root twigs, did our Arbor Day celebration. We planted all the bare root trees. And then all summer long, we just did all kinds of tree work. We've planted over 80 trees this fall. We have a complete inventory about to get delivered on. I've collected over $12,000 in fees and mitigation monies. Wow. From different site plan review projects that you were just talking about, which obviously is extremely important because that money now stays earmarked in a certain account for us to use for different things.
Did you say $12,000?
Yeah, we just got a check from, how much was the check from the Deaconess Rockridge? It was almost
$2,000.
Almost $2,000, so they had to do some tree removals for that addition they built, which was a project that was not prior to the significant tree ordinance, but it was just a bunch of public shade trees they wanted to remove to build a sidewalk, you know. So even though there was a mistake in how that all went together, we ended up in the end getting mitigation money. They replanted trees, so it worked out. And then really the final thing was moving that tulip tree. The big tulip tree.
I forgot about that.
That went all right?
It went fine.
Yeah, considering.
It was a learning curve.
Yeah.
Yeah, well,
it had a lot more roots than we had anticipated.
Yeah.
That was a good thing.
Yeah. Yeah, and it was healthy and we moved it. It took us longer to move it down the street.
The hard part was getting it from there to the park.
Yeah, because all the overhead utilities. Mm-hmm. And I'm not going to sit on my live camera, but we got it done. We only had one boo-boo, so we got it. But I mean, we've really
come up with a better system to move them, and I think we'd be fine.
Yeah, I think for me personally, I think I've accomplished a lot, but actually I wouldn't have accomplished any of it without all of you. And so the best thing is that after a year and a half, we still have a really great Public Safety Commission, very cohesive group. Willing to work together, communicate, work through any issues that have happened. Another important thing to me as well was keeping the tree crew together. So we've had some changes in the tree crew, but I've kept the same four staff members there. They're all highly trained, they're all highly motivated, so we're very fortunate, unlike other communities that don't have, you know, a lot of tree wardens don't have a tree crew. They rely upon the highway department to help whenever they can, or they rely upon Aspen Tree Service to take trees down whenever they feel like getting to it. So we're really fortunate.
Yeah.
There's a lot of different things that we're really fortunate to have, and it's just, you know, you sit back, you start thinking about it. Really, you know, what was it, 16 years ago?
It was a long time. Yeah.
16, right? 16 years ago, we finally did our first planting way back when, and you know, 16 years later, we've come a long way. Mm-hmm. But in a very short period of time, you know, as a public group.
Right.
So I think it's been, there's a lot of great accomplishments that we've done in the last year and a half that would have never been done if we not had the support of the mayor's office, the city council, right, and all of you.
Yeah, right.
So I mean, I could just go on and on.
Yeah, yeah.
All kinds of stuff, you know.
It's exciting.
And you at the helm.
Right.
Great.
Well, yeah,
that's true.
Well,
That's true.
We've tried in the past to get things done.
Yeah.
Somebody in your position is very important.
It's critical.
That's
true.
Yep.
I try.
Guys, you're inspiring. I'm serious.
We rehearsed this ahead of time.
Yeah, We did this all in the other room.
Well, you guys said everything pretty much. I will just say, for me, the number one thing was the tree inventory, because I feel like it's going to launch us to that whole other level, which we are primed to do. And like Rich said, we have all the pieces in place. A really highly functional tree commission. Phenomenal tree warden, a sympathetic mayor, and city council. It reminds me a lot of my experience with Grow Food Northampton, that all of these things had to converge all at the same time for it to be successful. And I look back on it and I go, wow, if I didn't have that one thing, it wouldn't have happened. And I feel that way now. So it makes me all the more ready to really stay focused on the next step, to, you know, to sink this thing in stone, to make sure that the plan that we are envisioning has the funding it needs and the people power and the political will and everything. So I'm super excited, and I'm you know, also mostly grateful to you, Rich, because I feel like it's, as Jay said, if we didn't have a tree warden like you, this wouldn't be happening. So.
Well, thank you. It's very rewarding.
Yeah.
You know, I have at times a very stressful job, and Terry can attest to that, and I drive Terry nuts probably. So that's an understatement, I think. But anyway, this is a really rewarding part of this job, actually.
Good, good. Well, we'll try to keep it that way.
There is an award you can
nominate.
Oh! All right. What's it called?
Tree Warden of the Year. So next December, so you gotta put this one in your cap.
Okay. When do you accept nominations?
It's the Mass Tree Wardens Association. So sometime in the fall. So, and I'm trying to get the word out more about it.
So nominations accepted in the fall. And where do we turn nominations to?
Karen Doherty, Tree Wardens.
So is there a website?
I've got that in the fall.
Yeah, okay. Mass Tree Wardens.
Great.
We might know next year's.
Okay, to do wrap up?
All right, there aren't too many, but this is what I got. Rich is going to get the Amherst nursery lists done by February. That's a little ways off. Tree City USA application by the 31st of this month. Gonna receive the Davy Tree Report hopefully by tomorrow, and send it to me so I can start including pieces of that in our draft of the annual report, and share Treekeeper with Lily. Lily's gonna reschedule with Carolyn and contact Molly Hill about no meeting on the 4th.
Thank you.
I would say, Jay and I are going to meet again, because I had a table. We came up with the tree list, and then folks wanted it to be in a different format. So,
okay.
I just had to table it till the end of my semester. I can't. So
meet again for the tree list.
I'll call you sometime in the next week or so.
And we should get together with Rich too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that would be good. That would be helpful. Mm-hmm. We can just kind of spend maybe couple hours.
Sure.
Going over both what your recommendations were, and then what else the Vermont guy recommends for planting layout. Mm-hmm. Planting design, I guess.
That's in that booklet, in that Vermont booklet?
Okay. Yeah, and if it's not in there, I think it's in the Cornell. There's a Cornell piece somewhere. I don't know. I've seen them. There's quite a few of them out there, so.
Okay.
But, yeah.
Motion to adjourn the meeting?
So moved.
Second.
On paper?
On.
Being adjourned.